Welcome to our weekly maritime vlog. I'm Corey Ransom with International Maritime Security Associates. We have Bennett, producer, director, editor, content person, the guy who makes this look good behind the camera. Mr. B taking a nap on the floor as he usually does when we shoot these. This week, we are going to talk about the dangers of ship recycling. So Bennett and I were just talking a little bit about ship recycling, and Bennett didn't realize, as I'm sure most of you don't, that large cargo vessels actually get recycled. Sometimes these vessels are scrapped and dropped to the bottom of the ocean for reefs. There's a huge process that they have to go through as far as emptying and cleaning tanks and a whole bunch of other things that need to happen before they can be put on the bottom of the ocean for reefs. But a lot of larger ships, because there is scrap value, get recycled. However, this process is dangerous and in a lot of cases deadly. So we thought we would highlight some of the issues and problems with ship recycling. But as you guys know, one of the things that I always like to bring up are laws and regulations that kind of maybe broadly or narrowly define some of these, how we do things in the maritime industry. And there is actually an international convention, again through the IMO, and it's called the Hong Kong International Convention for the Safe, Environmentally Sound Recycling of Ships. And this was adopted on the 15th of May back in 2009. So about 10 years ago, this came into effect as an IMO regulation. We'll put a link to this regulation below if you're interested in the regulation. And as we've talked about in the past, and just kind of a quick reminder, the IMO is the broad agency that sits on top of kind of all of these maritime regulations. So there's 194 member countries to the IMO. So out of that, these countries meet, the MSC, or the Maritime Safety Committee, meets twice a year, typically June and December. There's committees and subcommittees that work tirelessly throughout the year to look at different regulations and different issues that need to be addressed by the greater IMO body. So when the body gets together, they address just different issues and regulations from safety and security across every aspect from a vessel standpoint. So what happens is the IMO will through their General Assembly, will pass a regulation. What happens from there, then each individual signatory to the IMO or to the countries who are a part of that will then take that regulation and some actually codify it to law in their country exactly as it's written. Some countries may add or take away from that, but the IMO is typically the organization where everything starts. So just a little bit of a review for you guys on the IMO side of it. So this was passed back in 2009 because there is a number of issues and problems when it comes to ship recycling. Typically, ship recycling is done in three countries, in Pakistan, in India, and in Bangladesh. And there's three major shipyards that are responsible for ship recycling. And these three shipyards are responsible for roughly about 80% of the ship recycling. And in the process, there's a lot of things that take place from an environmental standpoint to just a human standpoint that are not good. So we thought we'd take a little bit of time to detail some of those. So many of you may have heard of the Gandani Recycling or Shipyard, which is in Pakistan. This shipyard came into the news back in November of 2016, so just a little over two years ago, that there was a ship recycling operation that was taking place on a large tanker vessel. Unfortunately, the fuel from the tanks had not been removed during the ship recycling operation. So what happens is there's torches and other devices that are used to cut up the ships. So you can imagine that if you're in a confined space and you still have fuel or oil in that space and you use a torch to cut into that space, one spark in those spaces causing an explosion, and that's exactly what happened in this shipyard. They believe that 39 people died in this massive explosion. There was media coverage on this around the world, but the interesting piece is here is they weren't sure exactly how many people died in the explosion. It took a number of days to put the fire out, And this again was after the convention, the Hong Kong Convention for Shipbreaking was put into force. So a lot of these shipyards will work in third world countries where the owners of the shipyards actually have a lot of power, where the governments a number of times turn away or look the other way when it comes to ship recycling. And the ship owners take their vessels there because the cost to do it is fairly cheap. If you look at what these people get paid in these shipyards, it's typically 1,000 rupees. If you convert that into the US dollar, that's a little bit on today's exchange rate, that's just a little bit over $7 for a 12-hour day for working in horrendous conditions. Most of these shipyards have no sanitation or bathroom facilities, no clean or running water, no real place for the workers to get out of the actual shipyard to take breaks. There's been cases where workers were taking lunch and pieces of metal fell on people taking lunch and have killed them. So these are extremely, extremely dangerous places that are not well regulated. Unfortunately, even though regulations are passed, it's up to the actual individual countries to try to put those regulations in place or enforce those. And some of these third world countries, because this is actually a lucrative business, decide not to enforce it. So there's a number of problems that still happen today when it comes to ship recycling. There are countries that do ship recycling the environmentally sound and right way. And it's interesting to see how a little bit of a shift is happening. There's a little bit more of an expense when it comes to ship recycling this way, but it's absolutely the right thing to do and the right way to do. This is a topic that we're going to continue to follow. Anything for us that has a human factor to it, we always like to follow it and highlight these horrible conditions that these people are under day in and day out. And at the end of the day, most of the owners of these yards and facilities actually don't care about the people who work there. So as we can get this information out and educate the maritime and the non-maritime public about it, that's one of the ways that we feel that we can start to affect change when it comes to these type of organizations and these type of operations that operate in a way that's extremely inhumane. Hey, thanks for joining us this week. We really appreciate all the viewers we have. If you have any questions about IMSA, about our videos, about me, send your viewer questions in. We are going to be putting a viewer questions episode together. So make sure you send us any questions that you have. We'll put them together. We'll compile them. And we'll have just a great episode where we do kind of a question and answer between Bennett and I. It's always a lot of fun. If you like these videos, make sure you subscribe to this channel so you get notified when we post new videos. For all the content that you enjoy, make sure you hit that like button so we know kind of where to go with the channel. Join us in the conversation through our social media, which our links are in the banner above and also in the comments section below. If you have any questions when it comes to maritime security, maritime risk management, or maritime regulatory compliance, don't hesitate to reach out to us because we're always happy to steer you in the right direction.